all of you are familiar with how wireless technology is impacting your environment today. You're familiar with social media and what social media is doing in terms of providing the capability to provide information to public safety that can help public safety be effective. We've seen how smart devices are impacting public safety today, with public safety officers using smart devices today. In the United States, there's over 50 million of these smart devices being used today. In Canada, there's over 56% of the population using smartphone devices today. And I know there's a very large population or percent of the population in Brazil that are using smart devices today. So that technology is impacting public safety in a number of different ways. It has the capability to provide public safety with information in real time. What I'm going to talk about today primarily is how information, voice and data, how it's converging, and how voice and data is really becoming a tool to build public safety's capability to be more effective in the response to citizens' calls for service. Next slide. So today, all of your personnel, and if you are police officers, your officers, have grown up, your younger officers, have grown up around technology. They've been accustomed to technology and using technology, so your officers and your workers have an expectation to be able to use that same technology that they have access to in their personal lives, to be able to use it in their professional lives. I mentioned in the beginning too, there's an expectation that your citizens believe that public safety has that same technology available to them to be able to use in their jobs every day to be effective and efficient in providing public safety services. Most importantly, the criminals have access to that technology today too. And that's a key point. Key point. At a very minimum, public safety needs to be as effective and have the same access to technology that the criminals have today. So what we see, and all of you today are here, you're talking about technology and how it impacts your business and how it impacts your professional responsibilities to provide services to the citizens of Brazil. I'm excited. I love technology. I love working for a technology company because I see the benefit that technology can really provide public safety. It's a huge opportunity for us who are public safety professionals to be able to leverage and use this technology to really make a difference for the citizens that we serve every day, that you serve every day. Next slide, please. I want to talk about a couple trends in public safety for you to kind of set the foundation for our discussion here this morning a little bit. So as we look at some of the trends in public safety, data collection is a key trend. I know that today here in Brazil, SINASP, and I apologize if I didn't pronounce that correctly, but SINASP is collecting data, correct? Those of you who are involved with that program are collecting data today. And that's a great, great first step for all of the agencies in Brazil that need to have access to that data. It's very important for them. So it's a very, very good first step. The next step, and this is something that we're engaged with at Motorola Solutions very strongly, is how do we get that data that SINASP is gathering and be able to provide that relevant data, the important data, not all of it, but what's important to that end user, that officer on the street, that officer that's responding to a call for service, providing that officer what's important to them, that public safety official, what's important to them, the investigator that's investigating a crime, having that data that's relevant, that's important to them, to be able to be effective, to solve the crime quicker. So that data collection is a great first step. Now the next step is providing that data in real time to your officers and to your people. In the United States and North America, as well as the rest of the globe, we're going to talk a little bit about kind of the movement towards predictive policing, analytics in policing, is becoming very, very important. In the United States, 70% of all public safety agencies are looking at ways to use predictive analytics to impact how they provide service to their citizens. No different than, I know you are here in Brazil today, in terms of how you want to use your data, how you want to use analytics with your data to be more effective. So this is not just a trend that is happening in North America, it's a trend that's happening across the globe. We're working with customers in Israel, in Africa, in Asia, in South America, around this very thing of being more effective using predictive analysis and predictive data. Another key trend that we're starting to see is the trend around security and importance of security around devices and cybersecurity. I know all of you are very conscious of security. You've seen all the discussions about how networks have been hacked and how data has been accessed by criminals and importance of having security around devices. So that's another key trend that I know we're focused on, as well as many of the technology companies that are here talking to you today, is the importance of that security around your device and managing your device effectively so that you can provide the type of data and access to the data to your end users that you want to, but you can do it in a way that's secure for them and it does not impact your business operations by having your networks and your systems hacked. Next slide, please. Okay, what I want to talk about now is the future of technology a little bit and what direction. We talked about this just a little bit, but I want to talk about it in terms of where we're at today globally. As I mentioned, today public safety is really focused more on response and it's a response focus. All right, being ready for anything. But what we're seeing is a movement to be ready for what's next. As I talked about already before, the importance of being predictive, the importance of trying to evaluate, trying to analyze where the crime problems are going to occur so that you can have public safety resources available in those areas so that they can address the crime problem more quicker and more effectively. So, as we look at this, we're looking at three different areas where I think the future is going to impact public safety response. First, how the technology and the analytics are going to improve officer safety. That's a very key important part, is how do you make your public safety officers more safe? So that analytics and that predictive policing capability help make your officers more safe. Another key component, and I mentioned this a little bit, is around solving crime, using technology and data to solve crime more efficiently and more effectively. We're going to talk a little bit about video. How many of you, raise your hands in the room here, how many of you today have used video or have responsibility for video in some way, shape, or form for your agency from a public safety use perspective? Are using video today? And very good. How many of you want to use video more for public safety? There's a very strong movement towards using video. We're going to talk about that a little bit here more as well today. The last piece, and this I think is very important, and that is technology as a force multiplier. Force meaning people, force meaning resources. I know all of you face the same struggles as public safety agencies do across the globe, and that is you have limited financial resources. So your budgets have been hit hard, like all budgets have been hit hard, right? So what you want to be able to do is use technology to help your resources and your people work more effectively and more efficiently. We're involved in developing some applications and solutions that can do that, that are really focused around data, focused around managing your resources efficiently. There's a big, big need by public safety to have those tools for their for management of their resources. Recently, I was at the International Association of Chiefs of Police Conference. Some of you in the room were at the same conference that I was. There was a lot of discussion by police chiefs from around the globe around data, around making their workforce smarter, and using data to support their operations on a daily basis. So there's a big, big push and a big focus on this aspect of public safety technology as it relates to how resources are deployed in the field and used by command officers in the field and managing those resources. Next slide. So here I want to talk a little bit about tomorrow, where I see public safety going tomorrow, and where we're focused at Motorola Solutions as a company, and where we're focused on. And that's really about intelligence, how intelligence can impact different aspects of the public safety operation, whether it be dispatch operations, whether it be actually public safety first response, intelligence officers and intelligence gathering capability. And it's really kind of focused around this, what I call the intelligence layer. And that intelligence layer is made up of voice communications. It's made up of data. It's made up of data analytics. And it's becoming more and more made up of multimedia and multimedia applications like video that are being used by public safety around the globe, as I mentioned before, to impact your operations. So, as we see public safety becoming more technology mature, we're going to see the capability, and we're seeing it today, of public safety be able to take this information. It could be intelligence information, it could be records information, it could be sensory data information, and pushing that information out to those police officers in real time. In real time. Building the situational awareness of those police officers. So as I talk about this data, for example, how many in the room are familiar with sensory data like ShotSpotter? You've heard about ShotSpotter application? So for those of you who haven't heard it, ShotSpotter is a sensory application. It's being used in the United States and other countries around the globe. It's sensory data. It's a sensory device that can be placed on a telephone pole or a building that can provide information on a gunshot to public safety in real time. So in other words, if I'm a dispatcher or I'm working in a command center, I can have a map. I can have that sensory data appear on my map showing me that a gunshot just went off at a specific location. That then provides me the capability to send my resources to that location quicker because I knew where the shot occurred. And if I have video available at that location, the potential maybe to bring that video in and see that video. So that sensory information, again, is all about building the first response capability of our police officers. It's getting them information that may be via the radio. It could be applications like eCitation, which would be an application I know that you use here in Brazil as well. It could be smart devices, the ability to access data on smart devices by your police officers. I mentioned video and other end devices that improve the capability of your officers every day to get that information in real time. When I was a police officer on the street anyway, 30 some years ago, And when I was a uniform police officer, then I was a narcotics police officer, we didn't have access to the data that officers have today. And I think about how that would have changed my job, you know, 25 or 30 years ago, and how it's changing the jobs of police officers today, and how it's going to be even more important down the road in terms of changing the job for those officers by providing them, again, that capability to have information in real time. The important thing about data, and I want to talk about this a little bit in terms of integration of data a little bit for you. As I mentioned, it's important to collect data. It's important to be able to share the data, but it's equally important to be able to integrate the data together so that you're able to use the data that's most important and most relevant to what's happening to you today. I want to give you an example of a police chief that talked to Motorola recently in Chicago. He was the police chief for the city of Chicago, and he was presenting at a Motorola conference for Motorola leadership. And a person in the audience, one of the Motorola people in the audience, asked the chief if there's one thing that Motorola can do for your police department, what would that one thing be that you would want Motorola to do for your police department? And that chief said, I want as much information about that call for service that my officer is going to. I want them to have as much information about that call, whether it be about the residents, past calls that happened at that location, people, information about people that may be at that location. I want all that information that's important to that officer as they're going to the call for service and as they are responding, to be able to have that information before they get there so that they can act smarter, quicker, and safer. And that's really, really the focus point of what we're talking about here today as it relates to technology, because it's really about making your citizens and your people safer. So the example that I talked about with Chicago is no different than an example that I think police chief in Sao Paulo would want, or the chief of police here in Brasilia would want, right? They want their officers safe, they want their citizens safe. They want to use technology to their advantage. And another key thing that I think is important, and we'll talk a little bit about it here as we progress, and that is being able to leverage your investment in technology and to be able to use that investment smartly and to build on that investment, so that you're not wasting precious financial resources that you've invested in your technology, but you're able to leverage that investment and use it for new technology. And I'll talk about that briefly too. Video, next slide please. Next slide. I want to talk about video for a moment. I touched on this earlier. Video is becoming more and more important for public safety, and we're seeing the benefits of video, how video positively impacts public safety, first response. A couple examples here. We did a pilot project with the Los Angeles Police Department, and we deployed video in what's called a Jordan Downs project. It was a high crime area of the city. It was a housing development. We deployed video at that housing development. We found out after a period of evaluation, crime reduced 40% in that housing project as a result of deploying video there and having access to that video by police officers that were responding for calls for service to that housing project. That's a significant impact, 40% reduction in crime as a result of using video. We also see how video really impacts prosecution in courts. 90%, in a study that was done, 90% of those individuals that have been arrested and convicted of crimes that were caught on video plead guilty, do not go to trial. We've also seen how video can be used to exonerate police officers that are accused of wrongdoing. By having that video available, it can help those police officers by being able to show, in fact, they may not have been guilty of something that they were accused of doing. So we see that very, very common in the United States, where we have a lot of mobile video deployed in police cars. We're seeing how that video is impacting the complaints against police officers as well. So, next slide, please. I want to kind of move now from data, video, and multimedia technologies to talk a little bit about voice communications and the importance of digital communications on public safety operations. As a brief history, I was a state project director when we built a statewide public safety voice system. It was a P25 voice system in the state of Michigan. There were 181 sites for this system. It covered 56,000 square miles. Today, that system has 1,400 agencies operating on that network, on that shared network. Over 70,000 public safety users, police, fire, EMS, public works, using that system today in a shared manner and having some of the benefits that we see that they get from being on a shared network that I want to talk to you about a little bit as it relates to digital radio. So digital radio provides, or really has grown, I think, because of a couple different reasons. One, it's easier to provide security around your voice communications with digital radio because of the encryption capability that exists on that platform. Second, it's easier to provide applications over the radio. So today, there's a lot of different data applications that we're able to provide or are being provided on voice networks, including text messaging on a voice network. So the ability to be able to do some data applications on voice, like GPS is another real popular application in the digital world that we're using today on voice radios that public safety is taking advantage of. So it's the ability to use those applications as well. I talked about security. I think another key piece of the advantages is really the digital voice performance of the system and the network and the clarity of the voice communications that you hear today. As you look at how some of the radio technology has evolved with digital, today there's actual noise suppression capabilities that are built in radios that really provide public safety the ability to communicate out on the streets in a loud environment very effectively back to dispatch because of the digital noise suppression technology that is there. So the technology has really, really evolved over the last 5 or 10 years around the digital world. So that's really some of the key drivers. And lastly, you're seeing a lot of governments really mandate that. There's requirements that from governments in different countries. We've had it in the United States. In the US today, if you want to use federal grant dollars to purchase radio equipment, it has to be standards-based technology and it has to be digital technology if the federal government is going to pay for it. So you see governments, and I'm not certain whether there's a mandate here in Brazil, I don't believe there is, and that's fine, but I'm just speaking globally, you're seeing that movement towards more standards-based technology. Next slide, please. So, when we talk about technology, you know, probably the two major standards globally are P25 and Tetra. Both very, very good standards. Both very robust in terms of providing capabilities to the end users. And as a former public safety person, professional, I'm very happy about what standards have done to drive better communications within public safety, providing more capability in public safety. I talked about the two major events that you have here coming to Brazil with the World Cup and the Olympics. I was the task force commander for the 2005 Super Bowl, and it was held in Detroit, Michigan. And we used our digital radio system for communications for that Super Bowl. And we had every agency that was providing security for the Super Bowl on the same network. So we had federal agencies like the FBI, the Secret Service, and the DEA, Drug Enforcement Administration. We had the local police, like the Detroit police, and we had the state police, like the Michigan State Police. We were all on that radio system. And we set up different talk groups on that system so that we could communicate in real time between agencies. So we used that shared network that we could communicate in real time. No difference, say, than for the Olympics in Rio de Janeiro, the ability for the state police in Rio de Janeiro, say, to communicate in real time with the federal police or with the military. The ability to have that real-time communications capability on the same network provides huge benefit to public safety from a first response perspective, from a public safety and officer safety scenario, and the ability, again, to respond more quickly to those calls for service. So again, we're seeing that benefit, and standards are really driving that. And another key benefit of the standards that we've seen is it allows you, as a customer, to really take the benefit of having other technologies, other manufacturers being able to provide equipment within that same standard for you to purchase. So it's really made the market more competitive from a pricing standpoint. And we're good with that at Motorola. We're not afraid of competition, and we like that. We think that's good for our customers. We think that's good for public safety. So that's another key driver, I think, that has been beneficial as a result of standards that are coming into play here globally. I want to touch on some key requirements that I think agencies look at when they're going to build a radio system. And I'm just going to kind of move through some of these. These are more informational for you in terms of best practices. But again, I think the key piece of some of this we've talked about is ability to have good coverage requirements, the right amount of capacity on your system for your users. We talked about security requirements as well. These are some of the baseline requirements that you need to think about when you're developing your requirements for your radio system, and also how you want to use data and what features you would want to have on your radio systems. So again, these are some key things to think about when you're developing your internal requirements around your networks. Next slide, please. Security is very important as it relates to voice communication. So the ability for you to make sure that you're thinking about how you may want to use security. Do you want to use encryption on your networks? If so, is everybody going to use encryption, or only some users use encryption? So those security requirements are very important as well. And who has access to the network, and how you track that access to the network. And there's technologies today, from a system management standpoint, that can help you manage that network more securely. So you want to think about that when you're thinking about your requirements for your system as well. Next slide, please. I talked a little bit about coverage. Coverage is very important, and coverage is very dynamic, because coverage is different in an urban environment than it is in a rural environment. And some of the things that I've seen happen in the United States with coverage is that sometimes agencies have looked at coverage from one standard approach, and they've looked at coverage regardless of the type of terrain and the types of buildings that they want to have coverage in. So it's very important to think about that aspect of the system in terms of what areas you're trying to cover, what coverage you want to have in the buildings or in outside on the streets, and how you can design your system from a cost efficiency standpoint to take benefit of how you place your infrastructure to gain that coverage that you need without overbuilding or overpaying for that. So there's a cost issue here to think about in coverage, and that's the reason I wanted to kind of bring that to your attention. Next slide, please. Disaster recovery and availability are key. We've seen this, I've seen this personally in 2003. We had a blackout in the northeast part of the United States. You might remember that blackout. It impacted my state, all the southeast part of our state, with most of our population, 5 million people without power. It's the second largest blackout in the history of the globe, basically. The largest one was in southern Brazil in 1999, and I know most of you are probably aware of that. In fact, I was talking to some folks before I came in here, and I understand there was a boom in the population after that blackout in southern Brazil. But that was something that I know all of you experienced, where the public networks went down, and there was no communications capability. In my experience with the blackout in 2003, our system was able to stay up and running, and we had public safety communications when the commercial networks were not available. There was no commercial network available to public safety, to the citizens, to the government leaders during the course of that blackout. None. Our radio system worked. We were able to give resources where resources needed to be. We were able to direct public safety response on that private network in a way that we could not have been able to do had we not had that private number in place. And we've seen that event after event after event. Key thing. Next slide, please. Text is coming. I think we talked about this. I talked about this a little bit, and as it relates to the radio network. But I know in the United States, the FCC is requiring commercial carriers to provide text information to 911 in May of next year. I know today that here in Brazil, there's a lot of talk about how are we going to be able to take text messaging into the dispatch center on 911 calls for service. So it is an issue that is not going away. It is an issue that public safety has to address. And the good thing about it is the technology can do that today. The technology is there to be able to do that for you, and that's a good thing. So now it's incumbent upon you to plan, as public safety officials, to plan for how you are going to address text messaging into the dispatch, and then again, how you want to be able to provide text information, again, to your officers in the field. Something to plan for, something to be conscious of. Next slide, please. One more. Okay, good. Next generation command and control, the command center. I believe that the command center is going to be the focal point of technology and public safety moving forward. And there's a lot of applications that are being developed today for that command center that will be able to improve your capability to address public safety incidents, to address crimes, to better manage major events, special events. And what I mean by that is the ability to take in data into the command center and video into the command center, and to be able to provide that information to a dispatcher or an intelligence officer in one view. The ability to integrate all of that information into one view for that dispatcher, for that intelligence officer, so they can make good decisions on how they direct their resources in the field. Let me talk about one example of that. Boston. Most all of you have heard about the marathon bombing, right, that just occurred recently in Boston. So as much as video helped them arrest and locate and arrest the individuals, it didn't help them stop the incident. Where video is going, it's going towards this issue of first response and situational awareness, the ability then to stop the incident, not just solve it, but stop it. Today, we're talking to the Boston Police Department about this very thing. The Boston Police Department wants to use video in real time. They want to use it as a tool to improve their first response and to prevent incidents from happening versus just using it to solve the incident after it occurs. And the capability to do that exists with the technology today in the command center environment. And I think that's something important for you as you are planning your technology programs and you're looking to make investments in technology, thinking about those applications, those those services and those capabilities that are available, how you want to use those in your command center environment, not just today, but again, moving forward down the road. Next slide, please. So to summarize, and very quickly, we talked about technology and how it impacts public safety first response. And we've talked about technology in terms of how it can increase conviction rates and it can improve officer safety. It can really impact the public safety environment. But I think the key thing here is what I really started the conversation about, is how you plan for that. How you plan not just what you want to do today with technology, but what you want to do with technology a year from today, 2 years from today, and 5 years down the road. Plan for that effectively. That allows you then to use your very precious financial resources effectively, and it puts you in a position where you're not making technology investments that you're going to have to tear out and replace 5 years down the road. Next slide, please. So just in closing, a couple best practices, keys to success, some experiences that I had. And I've talked about some of them we've already went over here a little bit. And that is when you're planning, and I know some of you are looking at your voice needs today, you know, you're looking at data, I wouldn't look at those two functions separately. I would look at, even though they're separate today, I would look at how you want to use those two capabilities down the road and plan for that, as I mentioned. You know, how you want to use data on your voice network. How do you want to share your voice network with multiple agencies and multiple users? How do you want to use analytics and data applications in your command center environment? Just begin to plan for those, I think, is a key component, a key important thing. Also, one of the things that I experienced, I built a system, and I was our state project director when we built our system in Michigan, is that it was important that we got it built. It was important that we built it on time and in budget. But one of the things that we didn't really factor for was the ongoing maintenance of that system from a life cycle standpoint. So it's very important to think about your ongoing investment in your network and how you're going to support that network from a maintenance perspective and from a life cycle perspective moving forward, and plan for that budgetarily. And there's ways in which you can do that, that our customers are doing that today in terms of how they are financing that. So just something to think about and talk about as you're doing your planning. So again, consider that mission critical need from a voice and data perspective. Plan effectively. Think about the long-term needs of your network. And think about how you can use that technology best to impact your public safety first response. So that's my presentation and conclusion today. Again, I'm very happy to be here. Hopefully this information is a little helpful for you. If you have questions, I'll be available here after the presentation. I'll be happy to answer those for you. And best of luck to you. Thank you for coming here today. And hopefully I'll see you on my next trip to Brazil. Thank you.